Heritage Media presents the greatest of vintage artists in classic dramas from America and Europe at the outset of the 20th century. Here is the legendary Ralph Richardson, starring in The Aspen Papers, adapted from the original story by Henry James.
This is Ralph Richardson. Our play today is based on a story by Henry James. Henry James, one of America's greatest writers, though born in America, spent a great deal of his life abroad, and his stories are often set in Europe, like this one, The Aspen Papers. The world has long recognized Jeffrey Aspen for what he was, perhaps the greatest of American poets. But I still think it was the English critic John Cumnor and I who had recognized him the most. Our edition of his collected works had not merely been definitive, it had been a landmark in literary history. Jeffrey Aspen had died young. In that he resembled Byron, whom he resembled in many ways, and whose death had occurred at almost the same date. So that when I first heard that Juliana Bordereau was still alive in Venice, it was almost as if I'd heard of the survival of Lady Hamilton. But it was not her memories of the poet that interested me. It was the rumor that she still had in her keeping the letters and the literary papers which Aspen had left to her when he died.
But all this fuss about a few old letters and papers, one would think they contained the answer to the riddle of the universe.
My dear lady, if I had to choose between that precious solution and a bundle of Jeffrey Aspen's letters, I know which would appear to me the greater boon.
Jeffrey Aspen? Oh, after all, he was a good poet, but
one doesn't defend one's God. One's God is in himself a defense.
But what makes you think that she won't let you see the papers? Have you asked her?
My dear lady, as I happen to know, the old woman won't have her relics or tokens so much as spoken of. They're personal, delicate, intimate.
But how do you know that?
James Cumnor wrote to her more than once. At last he had a reply, presumably dictated to her niece. Miss Bordereau has none of Mr. Aspen's literary remains, and if she had, she wouldn't have dreamt of showing them to anyone.
Then why all this trouble if she hasn't any papers?
But of course she has. You can see that from her reply, calling him Mr. Aspen. One doesn't talk about Mr. Shakespeare. Mr. Aspen proves familiarity, and familiarity implies possession of mementos, of tangible objects. As a literary critic, used to the finer shades of meaning, I can't tell you how that mister affects me. It bridges a gulf of 70 years.
Gracious, can she be as old as all that? Over 90?
But she must be. It's 70 years since Jeffrey Aspen died.
But if she refuses to part with the papers...
I must get round her somehow by ingratiating diplomatic arts, hypocrisy, duplicity, my only chance. I'm sorry for it. There's no baseness that I wouldn't commit for Jeffrey Aspen's sake. The palazzo where the Miss Bordereau lived was indeed decayed and past its best. It was large and imposing, but it showed every evidence of neglect. It was situated on a small canal in a part of Venice that was no longer either well-known or fashionable. There was just one feature about it which gave me the hint I needed. It was one of the few houses in Venice which could boast of a garden. It was on that lucky fact that I based my plea. I was shown into a spacious, shabby parlor with a fine old painted ceiling under which a strange figure sat alone at one of the windows. I was face to face with Juliana, Juliana of Aspen's most exquisite lyrics. And yet, not really face to face. She had over her eyes a horrible green shade which served almost as a mask and created the thought of some ghastly death's head lurking behind it. The divine Juliana as a grinning skull. The vision hung there until it passed. And it came to me that she was tremendously old, so old that death might take her at any moment before I should have had time to compass my end.
Our house is very far from the center, but the little canal is very comme il faut.
It's the sweetest corner of Venice, and I can imagine nothing more charming.
And you wish to take rooms here as a lodger?
You really must excuse me. It was the sight of your garden that gave me the courage to be so unconventional. I've fallen in love with the whole place, and I really felt that I must take the risk of offending you. Of course, I'll give you the necessary references.
If you're so fond of a garden, why not go where there are plenty to choose from?
It's the idea of a garden in the middle of the sea.
This isn't the middle of the sea. You can't so much as see the water.
But, my dear madam, I came to the gate in my gondola.
Yes, if you've got a gondola. It's many years since I was in one.
It would be a great pleasure to put mine at your service, madam.
I never go out. But you may have as many rooms here as you like, if you'll pay me a good deal of money.
I'll pay with pleasure, and of course in advance, whatever you think proper to ask me.
Well then, 1,000 francs a month.
Yes, of course. I'd found it surprisingly easy to get myself installed in the house, but that appeared to be as far as I was likely to succeed. For the next 6 weeks, I saw virtually nothing of either of my neighbors. Miss Juliana, I could understand, for keeping to herself, but Miss Tina, the niece, proved no less elusive.
Before you came, we weren't so private. But I've never been out in the garden at night before. Of course, it was never so nice.
Never, with all these flowers. And by the way, you've never thanked me for the flowers that I've sent you each day.
Well, I didn't know they were for me.
Well, they were for both of you.
But why should you be so kind to us? Why do you want so much to know us?
Now, that question's your aunt's, isn't it? You'd never have asked it if you hadn't been put up to it.
She didn't tell me to ask you, though she did tell me to come out tonight. She often does, only I don't like to leave her.
But is she so weak, then? Is she really failing?
She's been rather worse lately. Sometimes she sits so still, I almost think that she's died. She never eats anything. I can't understand how she keeps her strength. But she still gets up every day and clings to as many of her old habits as possible.
Must make life very worrying and quiet for you.
Yes, it's a lot quieter than it used to be. Well, we must be getting in. It's late. Do you study when you go to your room? I mean, read or write?
Oh, I generally read in bed. Poetry very often. 9 times out of 10, it's a book by Geoffrey Aspen.
Oh, we read him. We have read him. Oh,
he's my poet of poets. I know him almost by heart.
Do you write?
Yes, I write, but I don't talk about it in the same breath as Geoffrey Aspen.
Do you write about him? Do you pry into his life?
Now, that's your aunt's question again, isn't it? It can't be yours.
Please tell me.
Yes, I've written about Geoffrey Aspen, and I'm looking for more material. In heaven's name, have you got any?
Santa Dio.
She hurried into the house and out of sight. Somehow I felt that I might count on her in the last resort, but for the present she was visibly alarmed. The proof of it was she began to hide again. To bring matters to a head, I stopped sending up my daily bunches of flowers.
When you came here first, you offered me the use of your gondola.
But of course, madam, but I didn't know you went out much at present.
I don't. But why don't you take Tina out in it and show her the place?
But, Aunt, what do you want to do with me? I know all about the place.
Then go with him and explain. Haven't we heard all about the changes that have been these last few years? You ought to see them, and at your age, I don't mean because you're so young, you ought to take the chances that come.
Thank you.
was a strangely intimate journey that Miss Tina and I made that evening down the Grand Canal to the Piazza San Marco.
I found out what's the matter with my aunt. She's afraid you'll go.
But what's put that into her head?
Well, she wants you not to. She wants you to stay.
I suppose you mean on account of the rent?
Yes.
Well, I've no intention of leaving. I've my reasons for wishing to stay. The other evening, I almost told you how I wished that you'd help me to make them good.
I can't do that without being false to my aunt. She'd never consent to show you what you want to see. She's been asked before, written to, and it always makes her fearfully angry.
Then she has papers of value?
Yes, she has everything. She treasures them. She'll never show them to anyone.
But why? Why doesn't she destroy the papers?
Oh, she loves them too much.
Even now, when she may be near her end?
Perhaps when she's sure that she is, she will.
Mercy, Elvis, you don't think that she'll have done anything tonight?
I don't know. She's very cunning.
Do you know much about curiosities?
About curiosities?
About antiquities. The gimcracks that people pay so much for today. Do you know what kind of prices they bring?
What, do you want to buy something?
No, I want to sell. This miniature. I'd only part with it for a good price.
But what a striking face. Do tell me who it is.
He's an old friend of mine. But I'm afraid to mention his name, lest you've never even heard of him, critic as you are. I know the world goes fast. He was all the fashion when I was young.
I seem to recognize the face. Wasn't he a writer? Surely a poet.
It's only a person who'd know him for himself that would give me my price. Thank you.
Oh, then you have a price.
I know the least I would take. I thought you might know what I should be able to get.
Oh, it's a beautiful painting, whoever it is. And if you do decide to sell it, I hope you'll remember me. I should like to buy it, if I can afford it.
Hmm. What did you talk to my niece about the other evening?
I could hardly betray a lady's confidence.
Her confidence? Has my niece confidence?
Why, here she is. She can tell you herself. Have you confidence, Miss Tina? Your aunt would like to know.
Not in her. I haven't, sitting at an open window like that.
I know what I'm about. I'm not losing my mind, though I dare say you'd like to think so. Oh, very well, then. Move me.
Well, you must excuse me, madam. I'll bring you an opinion about the miniature.
The miniature?
What do you know about it, my dear? You needn't mind. I've fixed my price.
And what may that be?
£1,000.
£1,000? Gracious.
Well, is that what she talks to you about?
I went out of the house and walked far, far to the piazza where my restlessness declined to quit me. At last I took my way home again, getting gradually lost in the maze of passages, so that it was long past midnight when I reached my door. The sala upstairs was as dark as usual, and my lamp as I crossed it found nothing satisfactory to show me. The door of the lady's apartment was closed. Miss Tina had probably gone to bed. Miss Tina. Miss Tina. The door of Miss Juliana's sitting room was open, and I could see beyond it the faintness of a taper. There was no sound. My footsteps caused no one to stir. As I came into the room, the light from my lamp fell on a bureau in the corner of the room. Could the papers be hidden in that? Could they? And if they were, had Miss Tina already found them? Found them for me? Had she perhaps left the door unlocked for me? Was the bureau also unlocked? Had she left that open too? I bent down to examine it.
Ah, you publishing scoundrel!
I can't now say what I stammered to excuse myself to explain. I went towards her to tell her that I meant her no harm. She waved me off with her old hands retreating in horror before me. The next thing I knew, she'd fallen back with a quick spasm as if death had descended on her into Miss Tina's arms. I left Venice next morning, directly on learning that my hostess had not succumbed to the shock that I had given her. The shock, I may also say, that she had given me. At last, I could stay away no longer. I returned to Venice only to learn that the old lady had died some days before, that she had already been buried. It was with very mixed feelings that I went to offer my sympathy to Miss Tina.
No, I don't blame you for anything. My aunt has been ill for a long time. It was inevitable that she should die sooner or later.
And the papers, the Aspen papers? She has destroyed them, of course.
No, she left them in my care. There are a great many of them. More than I suppose.
You mean you've got them? May I see them?
I don't think you can see them. I've got them, but I can't show them. If you were a relation, it would be different.
A relation?
If you weren't a stranger, then it would be the same for you as for me. Anything that's mine would be yours, and you could do what you like. I shouldn't be able to prevent you, and you'd have no responsibility. I think I know what she wanted to tell me. That she wanted me to be happy. And if any person should be kind to me and should want... I don't know what to do or what to say. I'm too ashamed. I'd give you everything and she'd understand where she is. She'd forgive me.
I remember standing there and saying, it wouldn't do, it wouldn't do. Saying it pensively, awkwardly, grotesquely, while I avoided her eyes. The next thing I remember...
It was good of you to come and say goodbye.
Goodbye?
How are you going today? But it doesn't matter, for whenever you go... I shan't see you again. I don't want to.
What shall you do then? Where shall you go?
Oh, I don't know. I've done the great thing. I've destroyed the papers.
Destroyed them?
Yes. What was I to keep them for? I burnt them last night, one by one, in the kitchen.
One by one?
Yes. It took me a long time. There were so many.
This is Ralph Richardson again. This week, in our adaptation of Henry James' story, The Aspen Papers, the cast included Martita Hunt in the role of Juliana, Gladys Young in the part of Tina, and Cecil Chevereaux as Mrs. Prest. I should like to thank them, and I look forward to the pleasure of your company next week when I shall introduce another play. Until then, au revoir and thank you.
Sir Ralph Richardson starred in today's transcribed program. The script was by Derek Patmore. The music was under the direction of Sidney Torch. Theatre Royal is produced and directed by Harry Allen Towers.
This classic drama, starring Ralph Richardson, and with a supporting cast that includes Patrick Allen, Denise Breyer, Olive Gregg, David Jacobs, and Robert Rietti, has been a Heritage Media production. Heritage Media is part of the Divine Art Group.